So in this class, we'll be looking at the second and third commandments in due order. The second commandment is, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. And the second commandment points out to us, first of all, that God's name is holy. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Points to that positive duty of honoring the name of God. That name, which is not, you want me to ask what's in a name, that the name is not the letters in themselves that constitutes the name of God or the word God in itself, but it goes much deeper. The name is God himself, 1 and 3. And so the second commandment could be rephrased as, rather than read as, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, read as, you should not take God himself in vain. You should take God seriously. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit seriously. And how do we, on a positive side, we take his name seriously when we honor his name, when we praise him, or when we acknowledge him as God before others, when we are not ashamed of him. God's name is holy. And out of that respect for God's holiness, the people of Israel never pronounced this name. That name that was revealed to Moses in the burning bush when God would reveal himself as Yahweh, YHWH. And they never, for that respect for that name, they never called out that name. Rather, they would replace it with the title Lord Adonai, which is Lord in Hebrew, or Kyrios as it is in Greek. In the Old Testament, we find other names that they used to refer to God. The more popular ones are Elohim, which is in a majestic plural, like saying we. We or they, in the majestic plural, which shows that plenitude or grandeur. Or El Shaddai, which means the mighty or the omnipotent one, and amongst other names. But in the New Testament, what do we find? That God reveals himself as Father, Abba, Daddy, which is a familiar way of saying Father, that God must point out that he is close to us. But he's not our Father in the same sense as God the Father is related to God the Son. That God the Son is the only begotten, just the only begotten Son. But we Christians are adopted children, adopted sons in the Son. What does the second commandment forbid? Which sins are there against the second commandment? We'll list them in due order and then see them in detail. First of all, they forbid any improper use of the name of God, but not just of God, but of Jesus Christ, of the Virgin Mary, and of any of the saints, because they are related to God. It also forbids blasphemy. It forbids swearing to a falsehood, which is perjury. It forbids not keeping promises to God and vows that one may have made. And in fact, it forbids not keeping oaths. These we'll see in due order in the next slide. Maybe it's a little more detail, as we've already seen, that we said it's an injurious expression against God. Or, by extension, sacred persons or things. That one can actually use expressions that are injurious or defiant against people or things that relate directly to God. It's usually verbal, but it can be conveyed also through gestures or actions, or can remain in one's heart. That one can blaspheme in one's heart when one accepts those injurious thoughts in one's heart. And making use of God's name to cover up criminal practices, enslave, torture or kill people is also blasphemy. And while, as we said, using God's name in vain may be a venial sin, blasphemy is a grave sin. Now we look at the conditions for swearing. That to swear is to call, as we've already mentioned, to call God as a witness to what we affirm, is an act of worship. But there are circumstances when an oath is lawful. Remember those words when our Lord said, that do not swear on heaven because it's the throne of God, nor on earth because it is footstool. But at the same time, there were occasions where, because that people are allowed to swear, when the circumstances are right. And what are these circumstances? And what to be lawful if, first of all, it is taken in truth. Taken in truth in the sense that what I'm swearing to, that I know that it is true. Not that I think it is true. Not that maybe that I'm morally certain that it is true. Not that maybe and that may mean, of course, that maybe I was a witness to it, or that the person that told me, I'm certain of what the person is saying. Secondly, that one swears, second condition is that one should swear to something that is just. What does that mean? That one cannot swear to commit evil. It's a classical example of this is the oath that Herod takes in the Bible when he promises to give up to half of his kingdom, and then the daughter of Herodias tells him that she wants him to give her the head of John the Baptist, which means to kill. And so that oath is not valid if it includes committing evil. To swear to something that is just means something that is good, and not to swear to something that is evil. So you cannot swear to kill people, you cannot swear to steal, you cannot swear to insult somebody, and the oath will be unlawful. And then the third condition is that the oath should be necessary. For example, in a trial or on assuming an office. At times we see that with young children, that maybe they play football and then the person scores a goal and they're not sure whether it's a goal or not, and then they begin to argue and one says, I swear to God that I saw. At times those kind of oaths are unnecessary. There's no need to call God as a witness to something that is so trivial. And that we only call God as a witness to something, and that is to reverence God, because that thing is important. And so somebody to say, well, before I take an oath, to ask myself those three questions. Am I sure that what I'm saying is true? Am I swearing to something that is just, that is lawful? And is it necessary for me to call God as a witness to this oath? And if these three conditions are fulfilled simultaneously, then one can take the oath. Now, we look at vows, and we already said earlier on that a vow is always a free and deliberate promise that is made to God. And that the distinction about the vow is that that is a promise, that a solemn promise, you could say, that is made to God, that and not to other people, which would be an oath. But a vow is made to God, that is made to God, that concerns something possible, good, and better than its opposite. And many times, of course, the more classic ones, you say, well, the marital vow is made to God, that one will be faithful to one's wife or one's husband. The vow when one enters a congregation is made to God. And of course, a good action becomes more meritorious when it's done under a vow. When a person says, we have already sworn to something and promised God, it becomes more meritorious. But at the same time, a vow must be made with one, a perfect use of one's reason. That a person is fully aware, is not drunk, is not crazy when he makes the vow. The person also must have the intention of fulfilling the vow. That the person is not forced to make that vow. And then the person also should have sufficiently deliberated before taking that vow. So perfect use of reason, intention, and sufficient deliberation. And then finally, that the person should carry it out as a consequence of these first three. They carry out that vow freely. But at the same time, the vows bind only those who take them, not bind the people around them. And the obligation is serious if the matter is serious. It's not just I take a vow out of jest, or I promise God things out of jest. But vows cease to bind the person, and when they have been fulfilled, when the period of the vow expires, if a person with authority, because I cannot dispense myself from a vow, but a person of authority can dispense me, a person of authority who represents God, for example, one's confessor, can dispense one by annulling it, by dispensing the person of the vow, by commuting that vow, that's changing the obligation to another one. For example, the person says, well, God, I'm sick, I have exams tomorrow, and I promise you, or maybe I promise Our Lady, that if you're able to pass this exam, I'm going to go on a pilgrimage, walking from here, I don't know, to 200 kilometers, because the person makes that vow when he's in his sick bed and not maybe not with sufficient deliberation. But afterwards, when the person passes the exam, does well, and then remember, wow, I'm going to walk 200 kilometers in penance. You know, how am I going to do that? And then, well, the person can't change it. You know, but maybe speaking with the person that has authority, maybe wants confessor, can say, well, I mean, I think this promise was a bit excessive, and maybe it's better that you do, instead of doing walking 200 kilometers, you do, I don't know, some social work one weekend, and that's all. So that's what they mean by commuting it, so changing the obligation to another one. Having said that, but the point there at the end of the day is to say that, well, a vow is not dispensed by the person. It is dispensed by or annulled or commuted by the person, but by a third party who represents God. Now, the last thing we'll look at regarding the second commandment has to do with the Christian name. That in baptism, the church gives a Christian a name. And that name, as the Catechism points out, is a name that is for all eternity. It's a name that God, through the church, gives that person, and the name that God will call that person by for all eternity. And it's good that name be at least one that is not foreign to Christian sentiment. The name doesn't necessarily have to be the name of a saint, because it's nice when to have, first on the one hand, a patron saint that I'm named after, who is precisely that, a patron that I can appeal to for help and that I have a devotion to. But it doesn't mean, the Catechism also presumes that one can decide to take other names, provided they're not foreign to Christian sentiment. So imagine, I mean, something that would be foreign to Christian sentiment would be maybe to call oneself the name of a vice. You know, my name is greed, or my name is avarice, or my name is lust. It would be against Christian sentiment, or to call oneself the devil. But ordinary names, maybe at times, because we see that in maybe Nigeria, the traditional names usually have, well, a virtue behind them. Typical Igbo names or Yoruba names or Urhobo names, they have speak of positive things which are compatible with Christian sentiment. And maybe also with time, certainly that those people could also eventually even be canonized and become saints and become patron saints. So think of all the maybe traditional names that we have now. Because in the first centuries, precisely those names, you think of St. Francis, you think of St. Anthony, that those names were just ordinary names that they had. But they lived holy lives, eventually they became saints, and then we now take up those names. So in the same way too, that provided not foreign to Christian sentiment, one can take it up with the hope, of course, and with that desire to be that first saint that that other people will be named after. Now we enter the third commandment. Remember to keep the Lord's day holy. And in this commandment, the first thing, of course, that comes to mind, the first question to ask is, well, which is the Lord's day? Because in the Old Testament, the Lord's day, the day of rest, was Saturday. But in the New Testament, the Sabbath recalls in the first place the seventh day of creation, when God rested. And in that Old Testament, God decreed that all men should rest on that day, a holy day, set off and distinct from the others. And man was also to cease working on that seventh day in order to dedicate it to divine worship and to rest. But in the New Testament, what happens? That in the New Testament, Sunday, which is the Dies Domini, the day of the Lord, becomes the Lord's day, because it is the day of the Lord's resurrection, the day that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. We move from Saturday to Sunday because Jesus Christ rose from the dead on Sunday. And so if the Sabbath represented the end of creation, Sunday represents the beginning of the new creation, which took place with Christ's resurrection. And the liturgical book puts it in a very nice way. It says, well, they say that Saturday was the seventh day, and that seventh means completion. And then Sunday, rather than being the first day of the week, one can see it as the eighth day, which is like a perfection or a super perfection over that completeness that seven represents. So that eight, in a sense, is more complete than seven. That eight also, which is that Sunday, that eighth day, represents the beginning of that new creation, that God begins to recreate the world again in that new man who is Jesus Christ, and recreates the world again by rising from the dead. How do we keep the Lord's Day holy? How to keep the Lord's Day holy? One keeps the Lord's Day holy by attending Mass on Sunday, on the vigil of Sunday, where there are Masses, that certain Masses that are celebrated in anticipation of the Mass of Sunday, and also on days of obligation, as we will see. One also keeps the Lord's Day holy at the same time by refraining from such work or business that would inhibit the worship to be given to God, the joy proper to the Lord's Day, or the due relaxation of mind and body. And so that Sunday, in a sense, becomes not just, as in the Old Testament, the Sunday was principally a day of no work. In the New Testament, Sunday becomes a day of the Lord, in the true sense, a day of worship. And as a consequence of that worship of God, a day also to relax, work that will inhibit the worship to be given to God. And it's good to make that distinction, that Sunday is not necessarily a day of no work at all. Because in some certain cases, there may be jobs that one may have to do. In fact, for the first Christians, after our Lord's resurrection, they always met on Sunday. We read that, of course, that when Jesus rose on Sunday, the following Sunday, he appears to the disciples again. That's when St. Thomas will put his hand in his side and put his in all his wounds, and they say, "My Lord and my God." Our Lord appears to them on Sunday. He doesn't appear to them throughout the week. And they are gathered again, and he appears to them. Also, they receive the gift of the Holy Spirit 7 Sundays after his resurrection, on the day of Pentecost. They were gathered again. The first Christians met on Sundays, and it's very instructive to see how also on those Sundays, like St. Paul, once in the Acts of the Apostles, before a trip, he said after saying Mass, the homily seemed to be long, and then we hear how one of the boy that was sitting by the window fell down and died, and then he rose from the dead. That day also was a Sunday, the first day of the week. One, the formula tradition was that for Sunday was a day to commemorate our Lord's resurrection from the dead by celebrating Mass. St. Justin, a Christian author of the first centuries, less than 100 years after our Lord's ascension, also would write that on the first day of the week, they would come from afar and then gather. And that first day of the week, at that time, for the Christians, was a day of work. Because in the Roman Empire, they respected the Jews' Saturday, but Sunday, people went to work. People had to go to the farm or wherever, or to open their shops. And so what did the first Christians do? They would gather early in the morning, attend Mass, and then go to work. There was the custom of weekday Masses didn't exist. And so it was up to 535 AD, when Emperor Justinian, who was a Christian, now decreed that Sunday should be a day, decreed to several things, amongst them that Christianity should be the official religion of his empire, but at the same time also making Sunday a day of no work. So it's not the other way around, as some people confuse it. They think, well, that Sunday is a day of no work, so that we can go to church. Or rather, that Sunday is a day of worship, whether there was work or not. In fact, in some countries, example in Japan, up till now, many people actually go to work on Sundays. Many businesses go to work on Sunday because the Christians are a minority. And so there, of course, the Christians who are there who may have to go to work on Sunday have to plan how to attend Mass, which is what keeping the Lord's Day implies. But at the same time, of course, when one can or one should refrain from such work or business that will make it difficult to get that relaxation. And then for employers, it also means employers of labor also means being concerned and being really concerned and about making sure that one's staff who are Christians are not deprived of the opportunity of attending Mass or worshiping God on Sunday as they see fit. And that means maybe at times adjusting the schedules of work if they are shift workers, or making it looser so that one can go to church without any problem. But however, at the same time, a more important duty of justice or charity can excuse one from the obligation of Sunday rest. And here, I would like to introduce a concept that I think is very important to keep in mind, and that one is obliged to attend Holy Mass. But there's a difference between I can't and I won't. I can't means that maybe something comes up and the person cannot attend the Mass. For example, I'm on my way to church and then I have a breakdown, or I am sick, or I am in captivity or in prison. So I have not sinned by not attending the Mass, is that I cannot attend the Mass. A different thing would be that I can, but I don't want to, or I don't put the effort. A person who does not prepare on time and goes late or does not go at all. A person who doesn't put the effort. And in that case, one does not keep the Sunday obligation because one sins because he did not want to. So, and then maybe of course finally, to keeping the Lord's Day also means avoid making unnecessary demands that hinder the rest of others. Maybe an employer that decides to fix so many things on Sunday, so many meetings on Sunday, and it hinders the rest that others are due to the others. Now we'll look at what does it mean to participate at Mass on Sundays and special feasts. What does it mean? Is it just enough for me to attend the Mass and to be present at the Mass? The attendance at Holy Mass requires not just a bodily presence, but pious attention. It's sad sometimes to see maybe some people who attend the Mass, but they are there present with their bodies, but they are not there with their souls. They are absent, or they are there talking with their friends, or they are there getting distracted. Again, to keep very much in mind, of course, that attendance at Holy Mass, but not just a bodily presence, one participates in it as best as one can. Because, of course, a person who is 6 years old, a child who is 6, 7 years old, will probably get distracted after 2 or 3 minutes. An adult who can, an adolescent can put one's mind more. A married woman who has children who are running up and down will attend the Mass as best as she can. Maybe certainly if the children are running up and down, she may have to, when they are crying, she may have to carry them out, come back. But the point there is she tries to put her mind there as best as she can, because the same thing could happen if the person was sick and was falling asleep, or the headache was too much and the person couldn't really focus. The person also who is there will try to attend the Mass as best as he or she can. But the point there, we'll see the difference between, of course, that the person cannot attend fully without bodily presence and pious attention, which varies depending on one's circumstances. Then, keeping, of course, that participation at Mass is on Sundays is a grave obligation, because it has to do with that worship of God, which is fundamental. And of course, that Sunday is kept holy mainly by participating in Holy Mass, celebrated anywhere in a Catholic rite, unless one is excused for a serious reason. We already said that one maybe cannot go for certain circumstances, but maybe a person is not sure whether I can go or not. But a person may be excused for a serious reason, illness, maybe the care of infants that one cannot abandon, or the care of somebody that is sick and one cannot abandon, or maybe if the person is dispensed by their own pastor, as happened during the coronavirus lockdown, when the one's pastor, or in this case the bishop or diocese, said, well, there's no Mass on Sunday his diocese for this prayer because of this health emergency or this pandemic that we have. What is not the key thing about that dispensation is that, as we saw in the second commandment, I don't dispense myself. Someone who has authority dispenses me so that the dispensation is objective. That participation at Mass on Sundays and special feasts, outside, there are also other days that are not Sundays, that are days of obligation in Nigeria. And in Nigeria, they're just four. There's Christmas, there's the Feast of the Ascension, there's the Solemnity of the Assumption, and then the Solemnity of All Saints. These are the 4 days that may not fall on Sundays that are days of obligation, that are treated like Sundays, in which one is also obliged to attend the Mass, body and soul. And not just attend a part of the Mass, but the whole Mass. There's a typical question at times people ask. They say, well, Father, what if I came late after the first reading? I'm not attending the whole Mass. And here I will give my own personal opinion about the matter. That the Catechism says one should attend the whole Mass. It may happen that maybe out of circumstances or bad planning, the person comes 5 minutes late. But I can't say, okay, this is where the Mass, where it's no longer valid to attend the Mass. But I think what also do not make sense would be to say, well, maybe you go to a parish that has several Masses. I stay the Mass from the second reading, and so let me continue to the end, and then the next Mass I will stay there to the just before the second reading. So that way I took a half Mass here and another half Mass there, so that's equal to one Mass. I think it's being a bit cheap, you know, that's because the structure for the Mass, and so that the liturgy of the world leads to the liturgy of the Eucharist. And so when he says the whole Mass, I guess I assume one whole Mass. And so maybe it's better to say, well, and this is my personal opinion, that I attend the whole Mass. I was trying to come earlier than the Mass I want to attend, so that I attend the whole Mass. The third commandment also invites us to worship, to that public worship and religious freedom. The Christian doctrine teaches that people must be able freely to profess their religion in private and in public. And of course, in natural moral law, which is inscribed in man's heart, prescribes also that giving God exterior, visible, public worship. It's not enough to say, well, I will worship God in my house, in my room, on my bed, or in my own personal shrine. That worshiping God is a public function. It should be carried out and also expresses that unity of the body of Christ, which is made visible when we worship together, was centered around the Eucharist. So that it's not just a gathering of people, but rather a gathering of people that God has ordained. And so for that reason, it's important to ensure that people are free to profess their religion publicly. They are not just confined to corners. Of course, at the same time, respecting the freedom and of the others, so that we don't reduce their freedom, or we don't molest them or frustrate them. But at the same time, that people should be free to profess their religion publicly. And society and the government should not stop anyone from acting in this area in accord with one's own conscience. Of course, limiting of when there's necessary so that it does not infringe on the freedom of the others. But it should not stop people from acting, from exercising their right to worship God as according to their conscience. And with that, of course, sometimes, maybe one last point, sometimes people ask, well, what about this job that I'm doing? Is it compatible? Can I work on Sunday? Provided that work does not prevent me from going to Mass, then one can work on Sunday. But again, one should be prudent enough to say, look, because they're like in the entertainment industry, they work a lot on Sundays because that's the day they help other people relax. A mother also helps her family to relax on Sunday because she has to work a bit harder to prepare the meals, etc. Hospitality units also seem to work a bit more on Sunday. Of course, that work should not, and that's the key of it, Sunday is a day of rest, of worship, sorry, principally, and that due relaxation after worshiping God. And that work should not impede one from attending Mass, from worshiping God. That is the heart of Sunday. And that's going to apply to every other thing. Well, a student You don't have to study on Sunday. Well, you can study on Sunday, provided that it does not impede you from going for Mass. You can fix a meeting on Sunday, provided it does not impede you from going for Mass. If it does, then in those moments, that's when we have to realize that we have to put God first. You know, to say, well, that putting God first is to put the Mass first, that worship of God first. Because it's not Sunday, not that I keep Sunday as a out of obligation, but rather like Sunday as a that keeps man sane, you know, that helps me to realize that, well, that doesn't just live to make money or to make gain or to advance his own purposes, but that he lives first of all to worship God, and then other things fall into their place. And with that, this last idea, we end this class on the second and third commandments. May God bless us all.